Mic check 1, 2. Mic check 1, 2. Greetings, salutations. What's good, my dudes? How are we today? Welcome in, welcome in. Happy Friday. We are just getting started. We are just getting started. If you can hear me clearly, go ahead and click that screen a couple of times so I know that the mic is working. Awesome, Kaylee. Good to see you. Hi, Ashley. Hi, Peyton. Welcome in, everybody. Salutations. Like I said, we are just getting started. We are just getting started. Hey, Tim. How are you, legend? Happy Friday, y'all. Happy full moon. Happy eclipse. It's tomorrow, technically. But we're saying happy day early. Tonight, we're going to be doing 12 readings for all 12 houses. For the eclipse full moon. General readings for the collective. Yes, yes, indeed. Cheers, my friend. Welcome from New Jersey. New Jersey, welcome, welcome, welcome. We are just getting started. We're shuffling these cards, get these energy moving. I'm excited to see what they have to say today. We're about to begin. But we'll let our dudes jump into the room. So if you wouldn't mind keeping that feed alive by clicking the screen, we're going to start in just a moment tonight. We're going to be doing 12 general readings for all 12 houses of the Zodiac. Messages for the full moon. Hello, Gibby. What's good, dude? We are just getting started. Heck yeah, I'd love to hear it. Welcome in from Michigan. Michigan. Where are y'all tuning in from tonight? Do you know your big three? Curio, we're currently going to be doing general readings for the collective. So we'll be doing 12 readings for all 12 houses. Welcome from Colorado, Ohio, Utah, Arkansas, Oklahoma. This is my only account. I will never try to slide into your DMs and try to sell you a reading. All those accounts are fake. You can block them, you can report them, you can ignore them right away. Welcome from California and Philly and Florida and Louisiana. I think we got one from every state in here. Good to see y'all. Salutations, salutations, Illinois, Chicago. My big three are Pisces Sun, Gemini Moon, Scorpio Rising. And I am about ready. I'm super duper stoked. We're going to be doing general readings for this full moon. The recording will be up on my YouTube tomorrow, so if you have to go at any time, you can subscribe to me on YouTube and you can check out the recording of this live stream tomorrow. But we're about to begin in a moment, letting our dudes jump into the room. If y'all wouldn't mind, if you'd like to tonight, you're more than welcome to hit the copy of the link down there. You don't even have to send this to anybody, but if you hit the share and then hit the copy of the link, this always keeps it fresh on the feed. Hi, Somo. Hey, Riley. Welcome in, y'all. We are currently doing general readings for the collective, full moon readings this evening. And then after this live stream, we will do personal readings tonight. But right now, we are focusing, grounding, and flowing. I'm super duper stoked to get started. Are y'all? You ready? If you're ready for these readings tonight, go ahead and drop me that sunflower emoji just so I know that you are hearing me clearly and you are ready for these general readings for the full moon. We always start with house number one. That's Aries. Aries sun, moon, ascendance. That's the start of the zodiac. House number one is all about the identity. You as an individual, your eternal spark within, the light within. Welcome in, welcome in. I see all the sunflowers out here. We are focused. We're flowing. Let's get to it. Do we have any Aries in the house? Any Aries, sun, moon, ascendants? Wherever you have a Mars placement? Wherever your first house is? If you don't know your houses of your zodiac, you don't know your big three, I recommend you go look it up your natal chart. Your natal chart is basically your cosmic birth certificate. If you want to learn more about astrology, a great place to begin is the natal chart. We're about to start with Aries, house number one. We got a couple of sunflowers in here today. I see an Aries sun out there. We are so ready to play. The hermit for anybody, if you need to see him. I'm feeling so zen. Thank you, dearly. We are ready to play this evening. Alrighty, let's get to it. Aries, house number one. Sun, moon, ascendance, wherever you have a house. Wherever you have a Mars placement. First house, the identity. Any messages for this full moon this weekend? Let's get right to it. We are shuffling these cards. We cut the deck. We clear it. We let it rest. And as we do so, we shuffle the goddess deck over here, saying thank you to all of our guides and our guardians. Thank you to Great Spirit. Thank you to the Great Mystery. Thank you to the balance of the unity of God and Goddess for allowing us to continue to show up and surrender. Thank you to all of our guides and our guardians, our angels and our ancestors and our aliens, those watching over us and encouraging us to continue to show up. Right now, we are focused for house number one tonight. Aries, for you, my dudes, we cut the deck. We let it rest, and we draw two from the top. First general reading of the evening, we have the Five of Wands here. Lord of Strife, Five of Wands. Five of Cups, here in reverse. Lord of Loss and Pleasure. And the Princess of Wands, and the Root, Princess of the Shining Flame for Aries today. The goddess who jumps in this evening is Uzume, the goddess of humor. The goddess of humor here, reminding me that laughter is one of the best medicines there is. And it's so important to slow down and not take shit so serious. I feel like Aries can be pretty hot-headed at times, and they can take, because they're taking life way too seriously. Right now, we're being invited to tap into our sense of humor, to not get lost in the pleasure, to not get focused or not get distracted in the humor, but to prioritize cultivating silliness and playfulness and humor within our life, because ultimately this will help us remind ourselves of our youthfulness, healing the inner child, and returning to who we were when we first began this life experience. The Princess of Wands is reminding us the importance of alchemy, and when we invite humor into our space, we can then uplift the frequency of whatever it is that we're going through to an immense degree. We don't need to strive. We don't need to work so hard. We're here to work smarter, not harder. We're here to prioritize pleasure, but not get lost in it. And a great way to do that is to simply slow down and laugh a little bit. You ever tried laughter yoga? We can do it right now. It's really simple. Laughter yoga is just a practice focusing on laughing simply. If you'd like to laugh alongside me, I'm about to, so brace yourself. You can just let one go. Just like, even if you don't feel like laughing, even if nothing is actually funny, you can get that laughter out, and that's going to just start shifting the dynamic of your body, getting some energies moving so you can release, relinquish, let go of any densities, any patterns or programs that are keeping you stuck in the ugh. Right now, we're here to laugh alongside life, because I like to think that life is one cosmic joke, but ultimately, when we're way too attached and embodied to this reality, this material existence, we're taking things way too seriously, it's really difficult to laugh. That's why sometimes it's so good to just allow ourselves to do so. Maybe you want to watch some stand-up comedy, or you want to put on your comfort show, but ultimately not getting lost in that. It's important to have our mechanisms that help us return to our center, but not to wallow or get lost in those pleasures. This is where it's all about balance at the end of the day. Though ultimately, it's all in your hands, and you got the flame, Aries, and you know what you're doing with it. Stay lit. Don't let anything extinguish you. I appreciate you, house number one. What a great way to start this reading this evening. Simple, silly, nothing too fancy. We're going to keep this energy flowing with house number two, Taurus, my dudes. Especially underneath this eclipse and this full moon, shit's been real lately. So the more that we can just laugh alongside it, the more we can make light of this. Keep your heart lighter than a feather. Up next, we have Taurus. Sun, moon, ascendants. Do we have any Taurus in the house? Taurus is house number two. House number two is all about our values, where we are embodying what we believe within our core and our essence. Taurus is ruled by the planet of Venus, the planet of love and romance and desire. Right now, we are seeing if there are any messages for house number two tonight. Taurus, sun, moon, and ascendants. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. We keep shuffling these decks. Welcome in, everybody. Greetings and salutations. If it's your first time here, my name is Gavin Zen. I'm super duper stoked to see what these messages have to say for the collective today. We are currently reading for all 12 houses of the Zodiac, messages for the full moon. Super duper stoked to get started for you, my dudes. Taurus, house number two. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. We draw two from the top of the deck. We flip the deck upside down to show the root. We invite in one goddess for you. All of these cards are in reverse tonight. All of the cards are in reverse. I'm getting this reminder of what we are being called to do in order to get these energies integrated. First, we have the hangman here in the root. Spirit of the mighty waters, the hangman. Nine of Pentacles here. Lord of material gain. Queen of Swords alongside in the draw. Queen of the Thrones of the Air. And Nyx, the goddess of secrets for Taurus, here for you, my friends. I'm being reminded of this download that I received earlier a couple weeks ago. And it's that the devil is in the distractions. Heaven is hidden in plain sight. Ultimately, secrets are no fun unless you tell everyone, but we don't need to go around rambling nonsense. We don't have to tell everybody our desires and that what it is that we want to bring to fruition. It's learning the fine balance of speaking your reality into existence without overdoing it, not being too attached to it, allowing ourselves to surrender unto the cosmos, and reminding ourselves how perspective is everything. With the hangman here in the root, we're ultimately learning how to see the silver lining, seeing the divine within it all. Learning how to see heaven in plain sight, the secret, right before your very eyes. The secret, you ever heard of it? One of the basic beginner's manuals to manifestation, learning how to step into our roles as the creators of our reality so we can continue to speak our words into existence. See, the Queen of Swords, Swords is the element of air. Air is the element of communication, verbalization, learning, and mental energy. What are we focusing our mental energies on? And how are we wielding this awareness to shape the reality that is that we wish to see? Because ultimately, we're all dreaming. The more we can live lucidly, the more we can then create and live the dream, ultimately. And this is where the hangman and the nine of pentacles come into great play. Lord of material gain. When we're staying focused on that silver lining, when we're moving forward with an optimistic perspective, we can continue to ascend and uplift the vibrations and the frequencies, the densities, the distractions, the distortions to step deeper into our soul's mission and our purpose. May you continue to wield your swords, your words, to slay all of those doubts, those fears, those worries, those densities that are lingering and attempting to distract you from stepping greater into your role as the creator of your reality. Because this society attempts to teach us to place all of our energy into the external realm, though really everything is happening within. And the more that we can become at peace, we can become the masters of our mind and our emotions, the more that we can then ground into the roles as the creators of our reality and honor our destiny. It ain't easy, but the more we do it, the better we get. And everything is practice, practice, practice. Where you're placing your attention on a moment-to-moment basis will ultimately affect how your life plays out. And that's where the hangman in the root is so crucial for you, my dudes. What do you value, house number two, Taurus? And how are you living in according to your values? I value integrity and honesty, joy and gratitude. I value optimism and focus, precision, persistence, resilience. How can I continue to show up and live according to these values? Ultimately, this is what we are being reminded in this reading, my friends. Focused, flowing, power to you, my dudes. Thank you all for the gift. I appreciate it dearly. We're going to keep this energy flowing for the collective this evening. Right now, we're reading for all 12 houses. Up next, we have Gemini, Sun, Moon, Ascendants. Gemini is house number 3. If you dug that Taurus reading, go ahead and drop me either the Taurus emoji or maybe the bull, just so I know that you're out here vibing and you're ready for house number 3. Let's keep this energy flowing. Do we have any Geminis out here tonight? Gemini, Sun, Moon, Ascendants, Mercury placements. Mercury is the ruling planet of house number 3. House number 3 is all about communication. If house number 2 is our values, house number 3 is how we then speak our values into the space, how we communicate these for you today. We're focused. We're flowing. I see my Geminis out here. I see my Taurans as well. Let's keep it up. Let's keep it up. We're doing the thing. I appreciate y'all liking the live stream, keeping this fresh on the feed. Up next, we have Taurus, house number 3. Cut it, we clear it, we let it rest. House number 3, Gemini energy. Let's get right to it. We draw 2 from the top of the deck. We flip the deck upside down to show the root. And 1, goddess for you. Just like Taurus, all of these cards are in reverse. Seems some pretty strong eclipse energy on the horizon. And this is what's so important to remind ourselves to stay persistent and resilient and devoted, dedicated to our soul's mission. We have here in the root for house number 3, we got the 3 of wands. Lord of great strength for house number 3. Five of Wands in reverse in the draw, making another appearance here. Lord of strife. Perhaps Gemini is working with Aries, because we also saw this card for the Aries reading. Strong flame on the table. We got fortitude here, reverse in the draw. The strength card, daughter of the flaming sword. Five of Wands, three of Wands, fortitude, and the goddess for you, Gemini, my dudes. We have Serduin, the goddess of potential. Right now I'm getting this energy of self-confidence, of learning how to ask myself, what are my gifts? What am I naturally talented at? Where are my strengths? And how can I continue to apply my strengths so I can continue to slay the day? Slaying all the doubts, the fears, the worries. See, we can be strong and soft at the same time. And Gemini, this is the energy I'm being reminded to speak into the space. Even with the Three of Wands, Lord of Established Strength, with the Lord of Strife here, I'm getting working smarter, not harder, and how the strength of the mind will always overpower the strength of the body. And this is where it's so important to not just go to the gym just to get swole, but to go to the gym so we can train our mind, our body, and our soul. And that can be seen as like literally going to the gym and exercising. Or it can be just seeing as every single moment as an opportunity to connect deeper with our strength within, our fortitude, our soul, our mind, our body, and our breath. The more we can slow down and tap into this present moment right here, right now, this is how we then honor the infinite potential that's always possible. But when we get stuck in subconscious patterns, programs, just habits, when we get stuck in a survival mode, we're just going through the motions, we forget that we are always able to shift our reality. This is where it's so important to be clear in this present moment. This is when practices like meditation or journaling or self-reflection can help us immensely in this process of tapping back into this present moment where really everything is happening. The only thing that exists is right here, right now. And from this space, there is infinite potential to continue to create the reality that it is that you wish to see. Stay hopeful. Stay faithful. Walk this path. Thank you, Gemini. How are you speaking to yourself? And are you speaking with confidence? Are you speaking with clarity? Are you speaking with honesty? It's all about listening to ourselves, ultimately. We're going to keep this energy flowing for house number 4 up next. Thank you, Gemini. What an important reminder tonight. Strong eclipse energy. Do not allow these triggers to get under your skin. These triggers that are happening throughout this week can be our greatest teachers to help us step deeper into our personal power. Ultimately, we have house number 4, Cancer, up next. Sun, Moon, Ascendance for you, my friends. Cancer is ruled by the Moon, so if you have a Cancer Moon, it's doubly the energy. House number 4 is about the home within. It's also the first water sign of the chart. Cardinal water, reminding us of our psychic capabilities and how everything is water, ultimately. For my house number 4, my friends, let's get these cards moving and see what the message is. Sun, Moon, Ascendance, house number 4. This evening, we are focused, we are flowing for Cancer. We draw 2 from the top of the deck. Flip the deck upside down to show the root and a goddess for you. Still kind of moving with this theme of all the cards being in reverse, but this time only one is right side up, and of course it is the 4 of Wands. 4 for house number 4, Lord of Perfected Work. We have the Sun here in the draw alongside in reverse. Jumping out my hands. Cancer, Sun, Moon, Ascendance. We have the Princess of Wands here, reverse in the root. Princess of the Shining Flame making another appearance today. And Mnemosyne, the goddess of the past, here for you this evening. Playing on the theme of what we were just sharing with the Gemini reading, right now we're being reminded that every possible instant of our life existence provides us the opportunity to work on ourselves. Especially when you choose the journey of healing, the journey of spirituality, It ain't daffodils and dandelions. I think that's the most funny things about this day and age, because of like Instagram influencers and Hollywood. They're trying to make healing look like it's just like glitz and glam and just like fun and dandy. I mean, it can be, and it's important to prioritize those parts of our journey. However, oftentimes healing is ugly and uncomfortable and challenging. And this is where it's so important to allow ourselves to honor these aspects of ourself so we can integrate those aspects of the journey. Because the spiritual journey, the healing journey, is work. It's work. It ain't easy. Though every single instant we're provided the opportunity to do that work. So work it. Bitch, you're doing a good job. In case no one told you today, I'm so proud of you and I'm so grateful. May you continue to shine your light unapologetically. Unapologetically. Because when you step into your soul energy, this is how you can then burn through any of your limiting beliefs. You can alchemize, you can transmute, you can synergize. With the Princess of Wands and the Sun here, we're being reminded that just by being ourselves unapologetically, just by being ourselves, by letting ourselves stand in our flame, this is how we then transmute, we synergize, we harmonize any vibrations or frequencies that are not in alignment with our divinity. It's so easy to get lost in the past, or at least the illusion of the past. The past is not even real. The more we can stay here present in this moment and stay perfected in perfecting our relationship with our own personal presence. Because you have an essence, and your essence emits through your presence. But if we're lost in the past and worry and doubt and fear, it's difficult to then show up in our utmost presence. And this is where the real perfected work is learning how to cultivate your presence so you can allow your essence to emit through every pore of your person. And as you stand in your truth, you define your reality rather than giving your power away to the people around you who don't necessarily see you in your divinity, or a society that's attempting to siphon your soul's energy so you can waste your life building a society that doesn't actually want to see you succeed. We are here perfecting our work, learning how to stay unapologetically, unconditionally, boundlessly beaming like the sun. Because you, your body, is made out of the same energy that all the stars up in the sky are. And did you know that these human bodies give off light? In fact, they give off more light, cubic centimeter by cubic centimeter, compared to the sun in the center of the solar system. The more we can allow ourselves to unconditionally, radically, honestly love ourselves, doing the little things that make us feel good, prioritizing self-care and self-joy, this is how we can then reclaim our powers and anchor into the roles as creator of our reality. Because Cancer, house number 4, is all about the home. And ultimately, the home begins right here in your heart. And we can bring our home with us wherever we go. And when we feel at home within our person, this is how we can then stand in our presence, honor our essence, and allow our power to just pour through every pore of our person. You're radiant, my friend, in case no one's told you today. Keep shining. Godspeed. Thank you, house number 4. A beautiful reading. If y'all want to claim that message, go ahead and drop me the wave emoji. The wave emoji, just so I know you're out here vibing. And my question for you as we start shuffling for house number 5 is, what makes you feel most alive? What makes you feel grateful for this life? What makes you feel like a big kid inside? May you continue to prioritize your time, effort, and energy to restoring that energy within. Let's keep it moving. House number 5, my friends. Hey, I like how some put the hand wave. I was talking about the water wave, but you know, both work great. I see y'all out here. Powerful reading. Up next, we got house number 5 today. House number 5 is Leo. Sun, moon, ascendance. House number 5 is all about romance, desire, as well as the ego. How we are then stepping into our sun role and expressing our light unto the world. Leo, house number 5 for you tonight. Do we have any Leos out here in the chat? We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. Triple Leo. Super lit. I see you lions out here. We're focused. We're flowing. I appreciate y'all being here this evening. Let's get to it. This witch, super strong Leo energy. Wild one indeed. Aquarius is house number 11. We'll get there. But if you can't wait, you can catch the recording of this live stream tomorrow on my YouTube. Right now, for my lions out here, we cut the deck. We clear it. We let it rest. We draw 2 from the top. We flip the deck upside down to show the root. And 1 goddess for you. Alrighty, my dudes. In the root, we have the star. Not the sun card, but the star. The star is a sun, and the sun is a star. The daughter of the firmament. The star card here. This is you learning how to embody your star essence. The Knight of Wands, reverse. Cancer is house number 4. We just completed it. Now we're on house number 5, Lord of the Winds and the Breezes. 8 of Wands here, in reverse, for Leo tonight. Lord of Swiftness. Lord of the Winds and the Breezes, Lord of Swiftness, and Ein, the goddess of adaptability here. Right now I'm getting strong energy for house number 5 of being reminded that it's very important that we learn how to wield our ego. You see, society attempts to demonize the ego. We're taught especially in the New Age healing circuit, they're taught, people are like, you need to kill your ego. Like, no, it's impossible. You can't kill your ego because your ego is a byproduct of your body. The ego goes hand in hand with the rising sun, and it's how you express yourself in your life. The ego is ultimately also what you desire within your world. And we're here to integrate our ego, to heal our ego, not to kill our ego. We're here to honor our ego, but we have very piss poor examples of what egos are in this day and age because of Hollywood and because of the idolization of celebrities. Because most of those people have to do all sorts of demonic rituals in order to get into their spaces. And so ultimately their souls aren't pure for a lot of them. Unfortunately, it is what it is. But right now, we're learning on a collective level to honor and step into our soul's purpose and our reason for being here in this lifetime. And that is a very big part of integrating the ego, of showing up and honoring yourself, knowing that you are the shit. You are the shit. And that's not doesn't mean you're better than anybody else. You're allowed to claim your power. You're allowed to shine your light. And you don't have to squander anybody else because of that. So with the Knight of Swords here in reverse, I'm being reminded of looking at yourself in the mirror and complimenting yourself, honoring yourself, saying, yo, dude, you're a star and I appreciate you. You are a rock star. These bodies are made out of rocks and star energy. That's the daughter of the firmament, learning how to embody your essence as a soul beacon. These readings are just feeding into each other, ultimately. And now we're learning how to adapt and evolve accordingly, because this is how we continue to sustain our flame. We learn how to continue to show up and honor our roles as stars within our life. You're the center of your own solar system. You are the center of your universe. When you step into your star role, when you start really honoring who you are on a soul level, S-O-L and S-O-U-L, there's a reason why S-O-L, soul, is sun in Spanish. Because when you learn how to step into your soul, you then become a beacon of light. And you just being yourself is enough. But we're taught to compare ourselves to each other. That's not what we're here to do. Do you think the stars out in the night sky are looking at each other and like, damn, that star over there is shining much brighter than me. I need to burn faster and hotter in order to be more shiny compared to that star. Like, no, the stars aren't out there comparing each other to each other. They're just shining their light. They're just leaning into gravity and they're doing their thing throughout the cosmos. Just like we're here to do. Shine our light unapologetically without a concern about how other people perceive us. Because we are here for the people who can see us, but we're not here to settle or squander for the people who can't see us. If they can't see us, that's their own prerogative. And you don't have to stop shining just because somebody else is offended by the way that you express your light. If you know in your heart that you're not causing harm, and you know that you're just shining your light authentically, and that happens to trigger somebody, good for them. That's their work. Ultimately, as long as you're not causing harm, as the wise ones say, take no shit, cause no harm. As long as you're shining your light and you're not causing any harm, keep shining, my friend. Don't let anything stop you from that. May you move swiftly into this role as becoming the star of your reality. What a beautiful movie you can live, my friends. We're going to keep this energy flowing for house number 6. Up next, we have Virgo, Sun, Moon, Ascendance. Virgo, house number 6. So if Leo is house number 5, romance and desire and ego, house number 6 is about the work, how we then work on our ego, how we then work on our desires, how we then work on our relationships and our romances. Virgo is the embodiment energy. Thank you, Spirit. Cheers. Absolutely. Virgo, Sun, Moon, Ascendance, ruled by the planet of Mercury. If Gemini is also ruled by Mercury and Gemini is speaking, Virgo is the earth element of communication, body language, learning how to live our truth without even needing to use words. Aquarius is house number 11. We are now on house number 6 for the collective. Welcome in, everybody, if you're just now joining. Do I have any Virgos in the house? Sun, moon, ascendants. And if you dug that Leo reading, go ahead and drop me a sun emoji down there just so I know that you're out here vibing. Right now, we are shuffling these cards for my Virgo babies. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. Epic, y'all. I see you out here. I appreciate you dearly. Thank you for liking this and sharing this. Thank you for following. Welcome in. Welcome in if you're just now getting here. Right now, we're reading 12 general readings for the collective. Virgo babes, you get an extra card today. We're going to cut this deck, clear the energy. We let it rest for Virgo. Sun, moon, ascendants, wherever you have fire cards for Virgo tonight, wherever you have a Mercury placement. There's only, dang, this is definitely eclipse energy readings. We've gotten so many readings where like only one or no cards are right side up. So that means the fact that I'm interpreting these cards, the way that I'm interpreting all these cards in reverse, it's like how we are to focus to get these energies integrated so we can bring them right side up. We have the Hermit card here for Virgo. The only one that is right side up. Magus of the Voices of Light. Here you are tonight. Which is, the Hermit card is the card of Virgo. We have the Ace of Swords here. In reverse. Lord of the roots of the powers of air. I mean, I find it so freaking awesome that house number 6, the energy of Virgo, and we get the Hermit card. The only one that's right side up is the Hermit card. Like, that's synchronistic, to say the least. To say the least. We have the Hierophant jumping in as we're shuffling. The Hermit and the Hierophant. Like, super epic. Super epic energy. And the Sun. We have the Sun, just as we were coming off of that Leo reading. The Sun, the Hierophant, and the Hermit, and the Ace of Swords, and the Goddess for you. Iris, the goddess of rainbows, the goddess of communication. Virgo, this is one of the most epic Virgo readings I've ever seen. My goodness, my babes. Today, the message is loud and clear. You are the Earth Star. Learning how to just be yourself and wield your swords, your strengths, and your words. Like I'm saying, Virgo is body language. We are speaking always. We are always in direct communication with the universe, with God, with ourselves, because it is all God. God is life itself. It cannot be defined. The universe is life itself. It cannot be defined. We can get glimpses of it and it will hold some definition here and there, but the more we can just surrender to the fact that everything is always changing, the more we can then just ride these waves. And this is where it's learning how to find your seat within your body, becoming the radical witness of your reality, learning how to observe everything without judging anything. It ain't easy. This is what life is all about. And Virgo is the first star, the first sign in the zodiac to really give us this lesson. The Pisces Virgo axis, if you ask me, is what life in this reality is all about, learning how to embody and live the dream. So ultimately, we're being called, especially as we're closing autumn and we're stepping into winter, as it's getting colder, we're here to go inward. We're being really reminded the importance of developing a personal relationship with ourselves, a personal relationship with our breath, a personal relationship with our body and our heartbeat. So we can learn how the prana, the life energy, flows through our beingness. So we can then learn how to channel, harness, and direct this energy so it can be moving in alignment with the life that it is that we wish to see. Nobody can do it for us. And if we're giving our power away to other people, if we're allowing the society to think for us, then we're just wasting our potential. But you, all of you angels here listening to this random cat on the internet right now, obviously are for some reason inspired by this message. And I think it's so important that you continue to listen to those signs of inspiration, not because this cat is just speaking these words, but because you feel something within your body. It is so important to call your power back to you and then learn how to discipline yourself in calling your power back to you and working on it on a daily basis. This is what the Hierophant is all about. Somebody who shows up consistently, daily, moment to moment, breath by breath, heartbeat by heartbeat, returning inward ultimately, because this entire life experience, even though we're oftentimes lost distracted and distorted by the external experience. When we can bring it within, when we can reel it in, this is how we reclaim our throne, stepping into the center of our own personal universe, and then learning how to shine from here. Because you are the Son of God. You are the light. The more you can learn how to see yourself as such, the more you can embody this. So my question for you is, what makes you feel so alive? And when's the last time you just gave yourself time for yourself? When's the last time you took yourself on a date? When's the last time you just allowed yourself to play for the sake of playing? It's so important to just do so without the need to expect anything in return. Just doing it for the purity and prioritizing connection with self on a consistent basis. Prioritizing the connection with the self on a consistent basis. Recognizing that every day we're provided this opportunity. And I want to remind us that the sun is still on its first day. The sun has never actually set. You know that, right? Even when the sun goes down, it still rises on the other side. The sun is always shining. It doesn't ever stop. And you have the capacity to do the same yourself. And when we tap into our hermit energy, this is where we can then learn how to connect to our source within, so we can then burn up any doubts, any fears, any worries, any limiting beliefs, any illusions, so we can communicate clearly, confidently, compassionately. Thank you, Virgo, for being the beacon of this light. I love you so dearly. What an honor it is to share this message with you, my friends. Last little thing. I want you to start seeing your life as an investment, as learning how to recognize that every moment you are investing in yourself, whether you recognize it or not. The more that you can consciously bring your awareness to this process, the more you can utilize your time, your effort, and your energy, your real value, to invest in yourself. And everything that we invest in on a daily, consistent basis compounds. So if I'm investing all of my time, effort, and energy in just binge-watching television shows that are just wasting my life, then that's what I'm going to be building for myself. But if I am choosing to learn an instrument or a language or learning how to cook and eat good foods, if I'm learning how to hold my boundaries so I'm not wasting my energy on people who are not able to actually see me, if I'm learning how to honor and value myself and my personal energy on a daily basis, all of this is like compounding interest. It's going to build on itself consistently. It might start small, but soon enough, it's going to skyrocket exponentially. And every single moment we're provided this opportunity to return to ourself. That's what life is really all about, my friends. Thank you, Virgo. I love you so dearly. What an epic reading. I'm so excited. This recording is going to be on my YouTube tomorrow. So if you're just now getting here, you can check out the recording of this live stream. If you have to go early, you can check out the recording of this live stream. You can go subscribe on the YouTube. Go watch it there. Right now, we're flowing forward. If you dug that Virgo reading, even if you have hardly any Virgo energy in your chart, we all have a sixth house. This is the working on ourselves. If you dug that, go ahead and drop me the woman in the red dress emoji, because she represents Virgo to me. Go ahead and drop that woman in the red dress emoji if you dug that reading. We're going to keep it flowing for house number 7, Libra, tonight. Welcome in, everybody, if you're just now getting here. These are full moon readings for the collective. We're reading for all 12 houses. Dig it, dig it, dig it. All the dancers out here tonight, because life is a beautiful dance. Don't you ever forget that. Libra, sun, moon, ascendant. If Virgo is the work, Libra is the relationships that work builds, whether they be business, whether they be friendship, whether they be romantic or familial. It's all about the balance and how we then share those works with our fellow reflections, because we're nothing more than reflections of each other. Let's get it. Libra, sun, moon, ascendance. Libra is ruled by the planet of Venus. How can we build relationships balanced in love? Here it is for you, my friends. Any Libras in the house tonight? We're shuffling these cards, getting this energy moving. I am so grateful to be able to share these messages for this full moon this evening. Let's get to it. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. We draw 2 from the top of the deck. Flip the deck upside down to show the root. Epic. Epic. And for you, Libra, we have the Princess of Pentacles in the draw. Princess of the Echoing Hills. We have the King of Swords in the draw as well. Prince of the Chariots of the Winds. We have the Wheel of Fortune here. We have the Wheel of Fortune here in reverse in the root. Lord of the Forces of Life. The Wheel of Fortune. And we have Hestia, the Goddess of Home, here for you. Hestia, the Goddess of Home. I'm not answering any random questions right now. I'm staying focused for this evening's readings. We have Hestia, the Goddess of Home, in reverse, with the Wheel of Fortune and the Root in reverse as well. Princess of Pentacles and King of Swords, here for you, collective. Princess of Pentacles here, right side up, reminding us the importance, this has been the theme of the evening, the embodiment. The King of Swords here. The King of Swords, learning how to embody our mental energy, because we're nothing more than the stories we tell ourselves, and ultimately all of our stories begin with our imagination and our mind. How can you stay focused on that silver lining and that fortune, rather than wondering ways in which you can create doubt or worry or focus on the densities and the distractions within your life? Yes, home. Libra. It all begins within, and ultimately everything is relationship. Libra being house number 7, the house of relationships. How you relate to yourself is how you relate to others, and how you continue to stay focused on your personal work and what it is that you are here to do is how you then cultivate a home for yourself. Ultimately, recognizing that as we do one thing, we do all things. So how can I fine-tune my embodiment of my divinity, my practice, and my reality? And what can I be fortunate about? Because fortune is a frequency. It has nothing to do with material resources or coins or money. Fortune favors the brave. Fortune is a frequency. Fortune favors those who follow the path of their heart. Because we all have a heart. We all have a mind. And it's so important to recognize that everything is mental and nothing is real. Everything is illusory. And if you can imagine it, it's possible. So how can you wield your imagination to be working in your favor rather than be focusing on all the negativity that's consistently being projected into our space, either from the media or the mainstream or the public education system? We are here on the silver lining, walking the golden thread of the heart, learning how to stay focused on the fortune of our life, even if it's just being grateful to be grateful, being grateful to have a roof over our head, or food in our belly, or air in our lungs, or bodies that are capable of breathing. This little shift can allow you to alter the entire dynamic of your reality, because where your attention goes, your energy flows. And if you're focusing on the negativity, then you're going to be creating more of that in your life. But if you're focusing on the things that you can be fortunate about, then you're going to be inviting in more of that into your life. I encourage you to remind yourselves the power of the mind. King of Swords here. King of Swords here. Learning how to use your swords, because swords are words. Swords are words. There's a reason why it's the same word. You just take that S out, and then look, you got words and swords. We can either use these swords to create disconnect, or we can use these swords to cut out all the bullshit, to disconnect those things that are disconnecting us from ourselves. Ultimately, we're here to be mindful of the words that we speak, being honest, open, and clear within our intentions so that we're speaking with gentility and fortune and courage, consciousness, and creativity to the best of our ability. We're all learning, and nobody is perfect. Don't ever become complacent. Don't ever allow yourself to stagnate. Grace and gratitude and glory is necessary. Stay grounded, stay focused, stay true to you. Ultimately, my dudes, home begins right here. And you're allowed to say who's allowed and who's not allowed in your space, because this is your home at the end of the day, and no one can tell you otherwise. All right. Thanks, Libra. Solid message. If y'all dug that reading, go ahead and drop me the angel wing emoji. Go ahead and drop me that angel wing emoji, the wing emoji. My YouTube channel is Zen the Alchemist. You can find it linked in my bio over there. This recording is going to be up on the YouTube tomorrow, so if you got to go early, if you're just now getting here, you can check out the rest of these full moon readings for the collective on my YouTube tomorrow. You can go ahead and subscribe to the YouTube and check it out tomorrow afternoon. Next, we have house number 8 for my Scorpio babes. Welcome in, Scorpio, and happy birthday. House number 8 is about marriage. If Libra is about relationships and balance, 8 is about marriage, extending those, deepening those relationships, though it's also death and transformation. It's also the depths of the darkness. Scorpio is ruled by Pluto, the planet of transformation, the king of the underworld. Psychic capabilities and capacities. Also, dark money or hidden money and values. Next, we have house number 8. Happy birthday, Scorpio babes. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. Currently, the sun is in Scorpio. Moon is in Taurus. Just about in Taurus. That's what the full moon is going to be. With the eclipse on the horizon, this has been one of the most intense Scorpio seasons thus far, if you ask me. We are focused. We are flowing for Scorpio this evening. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. We draw 2 from the top of the deck. Epic, indeed. Of course it is. Of course it is. First, house number 8. Let's drink some water for you, my friends. Cheers. Scorpio. Today, we have the Ace of Cups, the only one right side up, and the Root, Lord of the Roots of the Powers of Water, Ace of Cups. We have 10 of Wands here, Lord of Oppression, 10 of Wands, the Emperor here for Scorpio, the Emperor, Son of the Morning for you this evening. And we have Lilith, the Goddess of Independence for Scorpio. This evening. Strong message on the table, with the Ace of Cups being the only one right side up and everything else in reverse. I'm being reminded of my Scorpio babes. Codependency is such a pattern of the past. Codependency is such a pattern of the past, and it's so easy to want to get stuck in relationships with other people, and it's so important to learn that the only relationship that really exists is our relationship with ourselves, and every other relationship that we experience is a direct reflection and extension of our relationship with ourselves. So how are we relating to ourselves on a day-to-day, moment-to-moment basis? You see, society operates on oppression by attempting to convince the individual to get stuck in cycles, patterns, and programs, especially ones that are built in survival mode, and the more that we can step into our power and become independent of all the cycles and the necessities, the requirements, the more we can then anchor into our sovereignty with balance, because we're not here to be hermits on a mountain just by ourselves. We're learning how to be hermits in the sense of the laws of hermeticism, learning how to tap into your own personal divinity, knowing that no one can do your personal soul's work for you. Exactly, the work. You have work, and it's important that you do your soul's work if you are here on the journey of healing, if you're here on the path of spirituality. But no one can do that work for you, and that's what a real emperor recognizes. And as you do your work, you undo all of the patterns and projections of oppression by standing in your regal, royal emperor, empress aspects, by just allowing yourself to be an Ace of Cups, allowing the joy of life to move through you effortlessly, learning how to get out of your own way. This is how you then undo all these attempts at oppression. Call back your energy. Call back your power. Stand true to you. Hold your ground, and don't ever compromise your integrity or your values because of your emotions or because of people pleasing or because of the projections of other people's limiting beliefs and worries and doubts. You see, Lilith was the original woman, but she chose to step into her power and not to succumb to Adam and Yahweh's attempts at ruling and oppressing her. And because of this, she was cast out of the garden. That's a very warped mythology, if you ask me. Personally, I don't believe that is really what happened. I believe that Yahweh is actually Set, if you ask me. Set being the god of chaos from ancient Egyptian mythology. That's how I perceive reality, but that's a whole other conversation within itself. We are here to free ourselves from the bindings of the oppressor, ultimately, to reclaim the power as the people, to step into our divinity so we can grow heaven on earth. And a big part of that is learning how to stand true to our own personal connection to the divine within and all around thee, and not allowing ourselves to waste our energy on the projections of the limits of the mythology of modern society. Reality is stranger than fiction, and we're here to step into our magic, to embody our soul's gifts, and to honor our roles as the emperors of our reality. You are the emperor. Your body is your empire. This is your land. You, the one who's inside of the body, the one who's the soul, who's guiding the body, who's moving through the body. You, the eternal essence, Scorpio. Happy birthday, babies. Congratulations, you are the emperor. No one can take that away from you, though you can give it away. You can give it away by acting in ways that are not in alignment with your highest good, by being reactive, by being attached. And this is where it's so important to be healthily unattached, to show up and surrender and let it just move through you. Ultimately, my dudes. Thank you, Scorpio. What a powerful reading for the collective. I'm very grateful to share this message. I'm going to keep it flowing. If you dug that, go ahead and drop me the Scorpio emoji, or maybe the scorpion, or maybe whatever emoji you want to go for it, because you're independent and you can do what you wish. Up next, we have house number 9 tonight. Sagittarius, Sun, Moon, and Ascendants. Sagittarius, house number 9 is all about divine wisdom. It's all about our connection to the divinity within and all around thee. It's learning how to surrender and open up to the higher guidance. Sagittarius is ruled by Jupiter. Jupiter is the planet of expansion, the king of the gods, the one who gets shit moving. Sagittarius is when we step into the divine aspect of the zodiac chart. House number 9 for you tonight. Let's get this energy flowing. We're focused. We're here for it. I appreciate all y'all and your comments. I'm out here in channel mode, just flowing. Sagittarius for you this evening. Draw 2 for Sagittarius. We flip the deck upside down to show the root. And a goddess. You. Outstanding. Only one card right side up, and of course, it's the 9 of Wands with the Sagittarius moon right there, Victoria. You see that? This is literally your card. You see the Sagittarius sign? You see the moon sign? Sagittarius moon, Lord of great strength, 9 of Wands. 2 of Pentacles here in reverse. Lord of harmonious change, 2 of Pentacles. Lord of peace restored, there for you. Lord of Peace Restored, 2 of Swords. And the goddess for Sagittarius this evening is Bridget. Bridget is creative spark. This is going to be kind of ironic, but this is the divine wisdom that's being guided through me at this moment in time. Learning how to sit and be still, learning how to maintain one's peace, especially amidst all of the chaos that's consistently being projected through the mainstream, the doubts and the worries and the fears of the populace who are brainwashed by the matrix. It takes great strength to maintain one's peace, to be like water, to flow, to be strong and soft at the same time. But ultimately, as you stay true to your Lord of great strength, that pillar within, this is how you restore peace, not only within, though all around the ASD, because when you stand as a pillar of peace, when you don't react and feed into the narratives, you can then hold this energy for peace on earth. And it all begins within. If you want to see peace on earth, you got to stop giving your power away. And you got to learn how to find peace within. It's good to be passionate. And sometimes the best way to express peace is to slay a demon. I'm not saying be passive. I'm saying those who want peace, they must learn when it's appropriate to utilize their great strength to slay, and when it's important to utilize their great strength to stay. And this is like so important so that we can lean into the path of harmonious change. And this is where Bridget, the goddess of the creative spark, is reminding us that we are always creating our reality moment to moment. And the more we can just allow the creator to move through us, the more that we can then step into our divine timeline. You ever heard of the law of one? The Law of One is an epic channeled guided work that was done in the 70s or the 80s, I believe. And one of the message that's moving through me regarding the Law of One right now is see the creator. Oftentimes the channel in the Law of One, she says, see the creator. This is where we learn how to see the Creator within every bit of our experience, recognizing that the Creator, that the Divine, exists within everything. Even the most chaotic and disorienting and distracting and disturbing aspects of our reality, somewhere there is divine within that. Or that divine can exist within you, being in your divinity and observing the reality without feeding into that negativity. Learning how to stay true to your core, learning how to wield your swords so you can remain at peace. Because a real warrior is always at peace within their heart. A real warrior who's here to like slay demons feels no remorse regarding the fact that they came here to slay demons. Like, do you think that Michael had self-doubt when he was slaying Satan? No. He was like, oh shit, like this is what I was created for. Like, all right, there's peace within me. Slay Satan, you're dead. All right, let's go. God has won. And this is like where it's so important to like learn how to not be reactive and to not feed into the energies of that which is attempting to get under our skin. There's a very fine line, and it's extremely nuanced, and only you can do it for yourself. But ultimately, as you just continue to prioritize your harmony and your connection to yourself, this takes great strength. It takes great strength. It ain't easy, but the more we practice, the more we show up and we train, the more we stay on track so we can be here as the conductors of our reality. We are here to be cosmic individuals. And if you've never listened to or read the Bhagavad Gita, I feel like this is a very important time to share this scripture with you tonight. Absolutely, meditation is life. Meditation is life. We are always meditating, whether we realize it or not. The more we can then focus and consciously and intentionally practice meditation, the more we can then stay grounded in that state of beingness. If you've never heard or listened to the Bhagavad Gita or read the Bhagavad Gita, B-H-A-G-A-D, Bhagavad, Bhagavad, B-H-A-G-A-V-A-D, Bhagavad, Gita, G-I-T-A. This book is one of the most ancient scriptures. It literally, Bhagavad Gita translates to the Song of God. It's not just a book. It's a scripture that was written. Yes, there it is, Kim. This book was written for the first time at least 5,000 years ago, much older than the Bible, much older than Christianity. However, it's not just a book. It was told and sung for eons before it was ever written down, and then before it was ever translated into English. This story is one of the most sacred texts to ever exist in this lifetime, and it's all about Arjuna. That's why I love that Victoria dropped the arrow, the target emoji, because Arjuna was the archer, and he was one of the greatest warriors, if not the greatest warrior during his time. But he had a lot of doubt because he was in a civil war, because his uncles and his cousins were trying to kill everybody. They wanted to take over the entire kingdom, and they're like, it doesn't matter, we're gonna kill you, it doesn't matter if you're our family, we're going to slay you because we want all the lands. And they're like, but wait, can we just like have this little kingdom for our family? And they're like, nah, it's ours. And they're like, okay, well, I guess we're gonna fight because we're gonna stand our ground. We're not just gonna give up and like surrender all of our power unto you just because you're being greedy and you're wanting all of it. So it's about a conversation between Arjuna and Krishna, Krishna being God embodied. And Arjuna's having this fight within himself. He's like, I can't fight my cousins, they're my cousins. And then Krishna's like, no, Arjuna, you have to fight your cousins, otherwise they're going to try to steal everything from you, and you're going to not honor your role as the warrior of this life. And the worst thing a warrior can do is not show up and honor their role as the warrior. If you're going to put your bow down and you're not going to show up to fight against your cousins, then your cousins are going to win and your whole family is going to die. So you might as well at least try to fight. And that's what's happening right now in the sacred holy lands. That's what's happening right now. That is why it's so important to free the people, because they have been fighting for their lives for eons. They have been fighting for their lives since the dawn of time, since the Zionist colonialist state has attempted to steal the power away from the people. And it's so important that we here in this realm of the world do our best to just maintain our own inner peace and not allow the stories of the mainstream to steal our peace, because then we can be here as holding the frequency for those within our own personal realities, because that's really all we can do at the end of the day. That's really all we can do, unless you have some will or way to be able to offer your power to assist. The only thing we can really do is just maintain our peace. It ain't easy. It ain't easy. This is what life is all about. This is why we chose to be here in bodies in this life at this moment in time, ultimately, if you ask me. This is really a big part of the collective initiation and soul experience. And it takes great strength to remain peaceful. It takes great strength to remain in tune with one's harmony. Because we are here for the people, for the soul. We are here to reclaim the divine heaven on earth, as it was prophesied, as Yeshua shared the words with the populace. Someone asked earlier, how do you meditate? Once upon a time, someone asked Maharaji, Baba Ram Das's teacher. Maharaji, someone asked, how do I meditate? And he said, you meditate like Jesus did on the cross. Meditate like Jesus did on the cross. With all of that pain, you feel it within your body, and you still are open in your heart. You're still choosing love. You're still pouring light from your eyes, recognizing that this life, it ain't even real. It's all an illusion. The more you can stay at peace amidst all of the pain, the eye of the storm is the calmest part. You meditate like Jesus on the cross. Shouts out Yeshua. Shouts out all the real warriors out here doing the ground and good work. May all beings be at peace. May all beings be free from suffering. This is a war over your mind, your body, and your soul. The more you can step into your own power and step into your connection and your relationship with your soul, the more you can make peace within your mind, the more you are winning. Because you are one. You have won. Bendiciones. Muchas gracias. Igualmente, mi gente. Muchas bendiciones. All right, we're gonna keep it flowing. We needed that though. That's what Sagittarius is all about. Thank you, God. We're gonna keep it flowing. Up next, we got house number 10, Capricorn, my friends. If you dug that, Sagittarius, go ahead and drop me that target or that archer, that bow and arrow emoji. Go look up the Bhagavad Gita, please. Please, please, please. Go listen to it on Spotify if you got it. It's amazing. Heck yeah. Cheers, y'all. Alrighty. Next, we got Capricorn, house number 10. Sun, moon, ascendants ruled by Saturn. Capricorn, for you, my friends. If Sagittarius is the divine wisdom, the higher guidance, Capricorn is the foundation, how we then build a reality of that. Bianca, I just got your Venmo. We're not currently doing one-on-one readings. We're not currently doing personal readings. We are currently doing readings for the collective, all 12 houses. Right now we're on Capricorn. We got Aquarius. Then we have Pisces. And then we're going to close out this live stream. Then we'll return for personal readings tonight. So that'll probably be like 30 minutes from now if you'd like to jump back in later. Otherwise, you can save that reading for another time. Right now, we have Capricorn, Sun, Moon and Ascendance for you, my friends. House number 10, we cut it, we clear it, we let it rest. And if you're just now getting here and you want to catch the recording of this live stream, it's going to be up tomorrow on YouTube, where you'll be able to listen to all 12 readings for all 12 houses. Right now, we got Capricorn, Sun, Moon, and Ascendance. We cut it, we clear it, we let it rest. Draw two from the top of the deck. Flip the deck upside down to show the root. Strong energy for you. Let's do it, my dudes. Two of Wands here in the draw. Lord of Dominion, Two of Wands. Seven of Pentacles here in reverse. Lord of Success Unfulfilled. Seven of Pentacles. Saturn and Mars. Lord of Sorrow here. Lord of Sorrow, Saturn and Libra. Yo, this is a strong collective reading, I tell you what. We got Nike, the goddess of ambition, the goddess of victory, the goddess of marathons here for house number 10. Strong message. We got two Saturn cards on. We got two Saturn cards on the table for Capricorn today. Saturn in Libra, Saturn in Mars. Excuse me, Saturn in Aries. Saturn in Libra, Saturn in Aries. Right now, Saturn is currently retrograding through Pisces. Saturn is completing his chapter through the zodiac calendar. Saturn is the world. Saturn is completing his chapter. He's ending his cycle in the zodiac sign. He's going from Pisces through Pisces to Aries, but that's going to be, he's not going to hit Aries until 2026. We got a couple years before that, but because of that, the world is ending. The world as we know it is ending. It's the end of the world as we know it. But that doesn't mean it's going to be bad or scary or apocalyptic like the mainstream has been attempting to brainwash the populace in believing so that they can create that reality. No, it's the end of that world. It's the end of Hollywood's world. It's the end of the government's world. And not God's government. I'm talking about the government that's been attempting to steal the mind, the body, and the soul of the populace for thousands of years. The end of the world is very beautiful. And as you claim your dominion, you can dance along the fire. You can learn how to practice your magic. You see, the mainstream society has done its best to siphon the soul of the individual, and yet they still have been unfulfilled. Their success is falling. Yes, shouts out Kali. And they're feeling sorrowful. But you, my friend, as the creator of your reality, have the capacity to wield this sorrow as sanctity. You can use this sorrow as your ambition, as the fuel to your flame. You can take all of this pain and you can find your power and your purpose. You can learn how to ground deeper into your soul's mission, into your reason for being here in this life. It ain't easy. I'm not saying it is, but the more you do it, the better you get. Stay resilient, stay devoted, stay persistent. Do not allow the sorrows to bring you down. In fact, allow the sorrows to be your reason. Finding your pain within your purpose, finding your purpose within your pain. Absolutely. Absolutely, the synchronicities work so good. We're here to dance around the fire, babies. Wasting all your time. Because they've been wasting, Saturn, the goddess of time. They've been wasting so much time. This song is known as Inner Bloom. Inner Bloom by Rufus Dussault. May you continue to stay true to your power, your flame within, your fire right here, my friends. This is what's going to assist you to be as a beacon in this ancient future that we are stepping into. It's not a new world. We're stepping back in time. We're reclaiming our divinity and what was meant for us, as was written in the prophecy. Godspeed. Keep it flowing for Aquarius, house number 11. Sun, Moon, Ascendance. Aquarius, Sun, Moon, Ascendance, house number 11. Up next for you tonight. The eclipse is tomorrow. And this recording of these live stream will be up tomorrow. Whoa, y'all. That's fucking awesome. My fire, it was going super. I have a fire in the fireplace right now. And like when I started this live stream, it was like going super small. But as I just completed that reading, it just started crackling and it's lit now. Magic. I'm telling you, it's real. It's so lit. Aquarius, Sun, Moon, Ascendance, house number 11. House number 11 is the collective, what we hold together. And when we show up in our power, in our divinity, in our regal royal aspects, and we reclaim our reality, that's why they call it the Age of Aquarius, because we are stepping into a space of unity consciousness. Aquarius is ruled by Uranus, the higher mind, the crown chakra. Aquarius, Sun, Moon, Ascendance. We're here for it. Let's do this. We cut it. Once more. Once more. Third time's a charm. We cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. We're shuffling the cards for Aquarius today. Right on time. Aquarius tonight. We're focused. We're flowing. Here for it. all the cards in reverse. Eclipse energy. Let's keep it moving. The Judgment card here in reverse. The Last Judgment. Spirit of the Primal Fire. Spirit of that Primal Fire. Ten of Swords here in reverse. Lord of Ruin. Ten of Swords. And the Ace of Pentacles here for you. Lord of the Powers of the Earth. Ace of Pentacles. And the goddess for you this evening, we have Rhea, the goddess of flow for Aquarius. Right now, I'm being reminded that we really have two choices in this life. We can either choose self-serving, or we can choose collective-serving decisions. We can choose to work for the collective or work for ourselves. Ultimately, what's so important to recognize is that when you choose to show up for yourself, you're actually honoring the collective. In a healthy way, but not in a disconnected way. When you think it's like, when you don't recognize the interconnectivity of everything, when you're only focusing on self-service from a space of the unhealed ego, this is when you're creating more disconnect. But when you're choosing to work on yourself, to do that shadow work, that's like the new, like, hip phrase in the new age community. When you choose to like integrate all of the work and the healing that you're here to do, this is actually how you serve yourself in a way that's serving the collective, because self-work is collective work and collective work is self-work. And this is where it's all about the balance. As you choose to heal all of your wounds, you learn how to mend the aspects of ruin, then you're ruining the collective's new, this current collective, this current society, this false synthetic matrix which we are inheriting that is collapsing right before our very eyes. When you choose to honor your role as a God seed, when you choose to recognize that you have everything within you that you need, you don't need anything outside of yourself. When you continue to cultivate your relationship within and you flow from this space, this is how you then can reclaim your role as the creator of your reality and be here as a pillar of ancient future, as they want to say new earth, but it's really just earth. This is what earth deserves, and this is what she's been here for. This is why she was created, to be like heaven on earth. Like, earth is Eden, if you ask me. It's just we've lost sight of that because we're wrapping up the Kali Yuga. Yes, just being yourself is necessary. We're not here to be anybody else, and no one can be you for yourself. Though ultimately, society attempts to brainwash us, to convince us to be contributing members of society, so that you can keep the system alive. The system would not be alive if it were not for all the people who feed into it on a daily basis. And yet it's still collapsing because it's unsustainable, it's irresponsible, and it has no way of actually supporting itself. Though you can support yourself, and you can learn how to tap into your own personal power, and every instant you're provided this opportunity of judgment. May you make wise judgments that are in alignment with your truth, with your divinity, and seeing the divinity within us all, because we're all connected and we are all divine. We're nothing more than reflections of each other. May you continue to flow at the highest frequency that you can possibly muster and sustain for yourself. And if you ask me, a great place to begin with that is gratitude. Gratitude is the shift in dynamic to higher frequency portals. And then as you step deeper into that gratitude, then you can create greater levels of unconditional radical self-love. Ultimately, the best and highest frequency is Godspeed, moving so fast that you appear still. Staying in tune with your own personal divinity, the source within, the only resource that you need, your mind, your body, your soul, that trinity. Learning how to see yourself as a multidimensional individual and not being so stuck in this material reality. Maybe that's easy for me to say because I've got loads of Piscean placement and I'm just like out there all the time. But that's why I'm here in this body tonight, so I can continue to anchor these energies into this space to recognize that we have a choice. And it's not about me at the end of the day. There's something greater happening. And it's just learning how to surrender onto that grand God plan. And I'm so grateful to be here as a vessel. What an epic, awesome journey it is. We keep flowing, my friends. May you continue to ruin that which is attempting to ruin you. Godspeed, my dudes. And next, we have Pisces, Sun, Moon, Ascendants. House number 12. House number 12 is about the subconscious, the unconscious, the dreams. House number 12 is that which cannot be defined. Pisces, Sun, Moon, Ascendance, ruled by Neptune. Let's get to it, my dudes. We're focused. We're flowing for you this evening. Pisces, my friends, we cut it. We clear it. We let it rest. From my fish out there, let's draw two cards from the top. We flip the deck upside down to show the root. It's fiery out here for Pisces this evening. But of course, we get the moon card. The moon card is the tarot card for the Pisces. Pisces is ruled by the moon. We have Mama Kila here for you in reverse, Pisces. We have the Knight of Wands, the only card that's right side up, Lord of Flame and Lightning. Fortitude here for Pisces this evening. Daughter of the Flaming Sword. Fortitude here for you. And the Sun. We got the Moon and we got the Sign for house number 12 tonight. Lord of the Fire of the World. The Sun. You see, the Moon is the guide of the soul. The S-O-U-L. The Sun is the embodiment of the soul. The S-O-L. Shouts out to the squad out here. I see each and every one of you, and I'm so grateful that you're here tonight, because we are not alone in this, and it's so much better together. When two or more come together, when the sun and moon dance together, this is where true union, this is where true divinity is created, and this is what we came here to do, this life, every day and every night. It's about to be a full moon tomorrow. We got the moon card out here. That's why we're doing these readings tonight for house number 12. May you continue to recognize that you are a star. May you continue to connect with that light within, bringing the light to all of your dark aspects so you can illuminate and ascend these qualities of self to step greater and deeper into your capacity as being a divine creator of your reality. Ultimately surrendering unto destiny, may you move rapidly like flame and lightning. May you continue to stay true to your fortitude, your strengths, your gifts. Wield your flaming swords to cut through all these illusions and these projections and these limiting beliefs, these patterns, these worries, these doubts, these fears. May you cast all of these lingering patterns, programs, projections, attachments, expectations, vibrations, frequencies, energies, echoes, any bits of thine experience that are no longer in resonance with your divinity, with thine divinity. May you cast it to the fire. May you alchemize. May you synergize. Energize. May you harmonize, may you tranquilize, may you relinquish, may you let go and surrender of any aspects of thine existence that are no longer in resonance with your soul, because this is why we are here. We are here to become beacons and embodied soul beings. That is what is required of us to step into heaven on earth. The matrix is breaking. We really don't even have to do anything. We just continue to show up and surrender and let the soul move through us. But ultimately, maybe that's a big part of our role here this lifetime, is to hold that space to watch it falter. But this has been revealed to me time and time and again this week. The darkness will continue to collapse on itself. We really don't have to do anything, because when we step into unity consciousness, the divine moves through us effortlessly. But if we're doing self-servicenessness in a state that is like unhealed ego, the darkness is going to fight itself, and then they just lead to their own personal demise and destruction. But if we're continuing to show up and shine our light from within to without, as within, so without, as above, so below, honoring the laws of Hermeticism. If you've never heard the laws of Hermeticism, it's required to step into the ancient future. And that is from a book known as The Ancient Future by Wayne Chandler, The Ancient Future, which is an epic depiction of the laws of Hermeticism. And these were the ways in which the ancient individuals of Kemet, ancient Egypt, before ancient Egypt even existed, these were the ways in which people were stepping into and embodying their divine gifts, recognizing that we are all God embodied, and we are here to reclaim this as we shift from the Kali Yuga to the Sattvic Yuga, from the age of ignorance to the age of the divine, the golden age. And the more that we can just stay clean in our thoughts, clean in our actions, clean in our interactions, the more we can then step greater into our divinity, because cleanliness is the is next to divinity. The more we can stay clear, conscious, compassionate, focusing on our personal path of self-love is ultimately how we then love the collective. And it's learning how to see that everything is connected. All right, that's about it. Stay fortuitous, my friend, because fortune favors the fortuitous. Fortune favors the brave. Stay strong. Stay grounded. Keep flowing. Yes, don't forget to breathe. The breath is your connection to your life energy. The breath is your tether to this present moment. May you continue to develop a deeper relationship with your breath and your power within. Thank you, my friends. A beautiful evening. This recording is going to be up on my YouTube tomorrow, so you can catch this. If you're just now getting here, you didn't get all 12 readings, and you want to rewatch this, or maybe you just really vibe the energy tonight, and you want to rewatch these readings, it's going to be up on my YouTube tomorrow. I'm going to close out this live stream. I'm going to go refresh myself, and then we'll be back on for personal readings tonight. I do want to let y'all know that if you ever wanted to learn the tarot, I do have a class that's called Intro to the Tarot, and it's happening on November 5th, and the admission is now. The admission is now live on my site. So if you wanted to learn more about the tarot and you don't want to spend years studying the cards or watching other people, you're more than welcome to join me for that class, Intro to the Tarot, and that is now live on my site. That's going to be happening Sunday evening, November 5th. You can find out the information over there. If you ever want to book a one-on-one, you can do that on my site. There are a lot of fake accounts out there. I will never try to slide into your DMs and try to sell your reading. So you can block them, you can report them, you can ignore them. You're always welcome to just kick it with us in the live streams. Monday evening, we have community meditation. That's free for everybody. I'll speak more about that this weekend. A lot of things happening here. We're going to jump off this live stream just to close it out so that we can then restart the live stream for the personal readings. So if you want to come back for those, I got you tonight. I'd be glad to read for you if you want have any questions, or maybe you just want to see what the Eclipse energy has in store for you. Yes, exciting stuff indeed. And we are out here being beacons, powerhouses. Proud of each and every one of you. I want to thank you once again for co-creating this evening with me. I wouldn't be here without you. I couldn't do it by myself. I wish you the utmost joy in your journeys, whatever you get into. Godspeed. Muchas bendiciones.